Macmillan Audio presents The Peacock Feast by Lisa Gornick. Read for you by Tavia Gilbert.
In memory of my father, Fred Gornick, scientist, explorer, raconteur. 1. New York, 1935. Shortly after Prudence's 23rd birthday, now more than three quarters of a century ago, her mother told her the story of Lewis C. Tiffany dynamiting the breakwater at Laurelton Hall, his fantastical Oyster Bay mansion with its columns capped by brilliant ceramic blossoms and the smokestack buried in a blue-banded minaret so as to foil the town from reclaiming the beach for public use. Prudence's mother was only weeks from death, and as she told the story, she wept. She wiped her nose on her bed jacket sleeve, eyes pinpointed from the tincture of laudanum Prudence had given her. Prudence had been born at Laurelton Hall, her father one of a battalion of gardeners who tended the glass genius's 588 lavishly landscaped acres, her mother one of a squadron of maids who cleaned the 84 rooms. They'd left when Prudence was four, her father assuming a position at the Tiffany's Madison Avenue mansion, but she still recalled the fountain with a color wheel engineered by Mr. T, so the water could be rendered different hues, the peacocks strutting across the lawn, the totem pole with a whale atop, marking the bend in the drive. Her mother, always tiny, but by then the size of a girl, reached a frigid hand out from the bed. She rested it heavily on Prudence's arm.
I was in the largest of the third floor bedrooms. No one slept there. But still every week they made me polish and sweep. When I lifted the window to shake the duster,
her mother shuddered.
White caps. And a terrible smell, like bananas gone bad.
She retracted her hand and picked violently at the nubby coverlet. Stop, you'll make a hole.
The explosion was so loud, I thought it must be the Germans come.
Like a faded photograph at the bottom of a box, the scene seemed to Prudence already known. The crackle of dynamite along the breakwater Mr. T had built, to expand for his own family's use the strip of sand that lay like an ermine cuff between his gardens and the sea that had once been the favored bathing spot for the residents of Oyster Bay. The plume of spewing water over the granite rocks, flooding the beach on which the town had planned to erect 35 cabanas on land Mr. T believed was his, and his alone. Why was her mother telling her this? Because there was no one else to tell. Prudence's brother gone now for more than a decade. Prudence's father dead the following year. Her mother pulled the coverlet up to the tip of her chin.
June 16th. 1916. That was the cursed date.
2. An April Sunday, 2013. At Prudence's age, 3 weeks past her 101st birthday, the phone rarely rings, so that when it does, a little after 2, she is startled, only realizing then that she has slipped into a doze in one of the wingback chairs by the library table, where she'd been drinking the Earl Grey tea Maricel leaves in a thermos, always with the strict instruction,
Mrs. P, you are not under any circumstances, not even Jesus showing up in this kitchen to light that stove.
A section of the paper has slid onto the rug, and as she blinks into awareness, she remembers it is Sunday, Maricel's day off. The phone does not ring most days because nearly everyone she has known is no longer alive. And for those who are, as she witnesses on her outings, she remains a surprisingly strong walker, though she does accede to Maricel's insistence on holding her arm. Talking as a means of communication seems to have fallen out of fashion.
"Hello,"
she says, disarmed, as she so often is when she hears her first words of the day, by how like an old recording she sounds, scratchy and faint.
"Hello,"
she hears back, a woman's voice, gentle, but with a backbone to it. "I'm Grace O'Connor." The voice pauses, as though aware that Prudence's breath has halted on the inhale. "My grandfather, Randall O'Connor, I believe, was your brother." Prudence does not blink, as stilled as if she'd met a black bear on a path. She stares at the knobby knuckles of what had once been, she'd been told, lovely hands, at the highway of raised blood vessels visible through her parchment skin.
"No, no thank you, I have no need of that,"
are the words she hears in her head.
"I think I am your great niece."
There is no tacked-on silly laugh, and with this, Prudence senses a grown woman, which makes sense. Her own grandchildren, had she had children, might have been, as she's calculated, grandparents themselves. But her mind is not making those idle calculations now. Rather, wild, impetuous animal, it has leaped back to the day, a rare pocket of vivid memory, when they received the first letter from Randall, then only 14. A letter, it appeared from the postmark, that had taken 3 weeks to travel from his lodgings in San Francisco to Hell's Kitchen. That Randall had written it all had dwarfed the content of the letter, which contained little news save that he was staying with Charlie, a boy he knew from New York, and that he'd found a job as a florist's assistant. After her mother read the single page aloud, her father wiped his eyes with the back of his hand.
"Well, he knows about flowers from me," he said,
and her mother sucked her lips into her mouth. Holding back, Prudence imagines, "Go to hell, Eddie, it's because of you, stupid drunk, that he's gone." Her father had not been a stupid drunk, but when he did drink, he could get sloppy and mean as he had the night Randall left. A night when he'd shoved her mother, and Randall, who boxed at the place around the corner and had a quick right jab, made fists, and her father, who had never hit them, swung at Randall.
"Grace? Is that what the woman said?"
Folded inside the letter to her parents was a separate one for her.
"Prue, you're the smartest of us all. Just stay clear of our father when he's had a few. He's not a bad man, but the whiskey makes him... well, I don't want to cuss."
There were a few lines about how Randall would see her soon. Maybe not this Christmas, but Christmas the next at the most. But then Christmas and Christmas the next had passed without Randall's coming back, and the spans between his letters grew longer and longer. When her father died the following year and her aunt sent a telegram to Randall's rooming house, his landlady cabled back, "moved." A decade later, after her mother died, Prudence did not even know where to send a telegram. But now the woman, Grace, is explaining that Randall, her grandfather, has been dead for nearly 20 years, that he had one child, her father, Leopold. A shock passes through Prudence. Of course, she's known her brother must be gone by now, but hearing it, hearing how long it's been, she closes her eyes so as to do the arithmetic in her head. Randall was 3 years older than her. 20 years ago, he would have been 84. "I am wondering if I might see you," the woman says.
"See her? See a photograph of her? Pull yourself together,"
Prudence admonishes herself, by which she means gather up her thoughts, with their inclination of late to wander off like toddlers willy-nilly wherever they want.
have a visit. You are wondering if we might have a visit?
Yes. Would you be willing?
The no thank you, returns.
Dorothy Tiffany, the daughter of her parents' employer who'd once told Prudence, "We must shoulder failing those we love," would have come right out and said it, a firm no. But she, Prudence Theat, nay Prudence O'Connor, cannot do that.
"When will you be in New York?"
Prudence asks. There is a pause, and for a moment Prudence thinks perhaps the line has gone dead.
"I'm sorry. I should have said this before. I am in New York now."
Prudence's heart pounds wildly, as though the black bear has reared onto its hind legs.
Actually, I'm outside your building now.
You're outside my building now?
Yes.
To Prudence's amazement, the bear turns and saunters into the trees, leaving something she hasn't felt in a long time. Something she would have to say is closer to elation than fear. Such a long time since she has done anything more spontaneous, more rash than stopping with Maricel on one of their walks to buy an Italian ice from a cart. She hears Maricel scolding,
"Mrs. P, it could be someone come to rob you. Or worse than that, there are evil people out there. They prey on elderly persons."
But this is not people. This is her brother's grandchild. And if it is not, if it is someone come to do her harm, what difference will it make? She is in her final passage. There is no arguing about that. The only question is, a passage to where? Her mother, with her cries in her final days of Eddie and Oliver, had believed to heaven. The latter name Prudence had not recognized. An early love? A late love, such as she, Prudence, once had? But her father, Eddie. Prudence had not reminded her mother that if there was a heaven, he might or might not be there.
"Well, then, please come up."
After the doorman calls to announce a Miss O'Connor, Prudence grips the arms of the wingback chair and pushes herself to her feet. Usually, her afternoons are dotted with catnaps, the outcome of her invariable 4:53 awakenings, nature's timepiece set in her brainstem with the exactitude her husband Carlton had once described to her of a school of salmon's return to the very waters where they'd been born so as to spawn and then die. She rests for a moment, holding the edge of the library table and looking out at the great expanse of the Hudson, the West Side Highway hidden behind park foliage thick as bunches of broccoli. The New Jersey waterfront was largely undeveloped when she'd moved here from Park Avenue, a few years after Carlton's death. Now high-rises are visible from her 15th floor window, and a driving range that from this distance might be a leprechaun's kerchief smoothed over the ground. Only the river is unchanged. In winter, there are ice floes and wind-whipped waves. In summer, skies dressed at sunset with plum and papaya stripes. A vista, it saddens her to think, that has brought her more consistent pleasure, provided a more enduring connection, than anything human or animal. When Carlton died, she'd been 37, childless, her parents long gone. Randall drifted so far away, it was as if he'd disappeared. A few months later, on the insistence of Harriet Masters, in whose interior decoration firm Prudence had worked prior to her marriage, she consulted the psychiatrist Harriet had seen after her husband, presumably heartbroken from one of the torrid affairs he'd conducted with the wives of his fellow club members, but, Harriet claimed, more bored than distraught, hung himself in the attic of their Tuxedo Park home. When the psychiatrist asked about Prudence's friendships, she told him about Ella, with whom she'd briefly been intimate, and Elaine, with whom she'd worked at Harriet's firm. On occasion, she reported, she and Carlton had socialized with Carlton's business associates and college friends and their wives. most particularly Alfred, Carlton's mountaineering partner. Their most regular dinner companion, however, had been CCB, for whom Carlton had become a surrogate son after his own son, married to Dorothy Tiffany, had become debilitated from manic depressive illness. At the end of the meeting, the psychiatrist diagnosed Prudence as suffering from an overwhelming loneliness that predated the loss of Carlton. The problem, he gently explained, was not a lack of companions, but there was not a one with whom she could talk about anything not found in a newspaper, much less, God forbid, cry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.